KFAR.
It will be found an unjust and unwise jealousy to deprive a man of his natural liberty upon the supposition he may abuse it. George Washington.
They who would give up an essential liberty for temporary security deserve neither liberty or security. Benjamin Franklin.
The Constitution is not an instrument for the government to restrain the people. It is an instrument for the people to restrain the government, lest it come to dominate our lives and interests. Patrick Henry.
America will never be destroyed from the outside. If we falter and lose our freedoms, it would be because we destroyed ourselves, Abraham Lincoln.
I predict future happiness for Americans if they can prevent the government from wasting the labors of the people under the pretense of taking care of them. Thomas Jefferson.
Property is surely a right of mankind as real as liberty. John Adams.
The Constitution is a guide which I never will abandon. George Washington.
Some heavy things. It seems like this world ain't getting any better.
Lord, though I walk through the valley of the
more we try to get closer to you, the farther we run from your throne. I spent so many nights wondering, when will it end? When will the day come when happiness begins? I'm running the race, but it seems so hard to win. I'm sick of mourning, my stomach is throwing up in the morning. I'm calling for help and watching it melt away. My heart's been put on display and put away in many ways. Many times I told myself it was okay, and anger was the price that was paid. While these faded dreams just scream to bring them home, the burden was too heavy, I kept running from the throne. I can't take it anymore. I can taste my spirit hunger. God, please help me get home.
And welcome to Hour 1 of Patriots Lament. We like to call it the Saturday morning wake-up call because we'd like you to wake up. I'm Steve Floyd, the man with a face made for radio, and I'm just the monkey behind the machine here today. The real brains of the operation is sitting across from me over here, Aaron Bennett. Good morning, Aaron.
Good morning, Steve.
It's good to have you here in the studio so bright and early on a Saturday morning.
Oh, thank you. I don't know how much of the brains I'll be. I haven't slept since yesterday sometime.
Well, that's perfect.
But I am wearing Dave Giesel's old headset, so that's got to count for some kind of IQ boost.
Well, if IQ could be transferred like germs, then yes, then you'd be set. You'd be good to go.
You mean they can't?
Well, the last I heard, the only way you really, in order to get actual brains, you have to go to a government-sponsored school and be indoctrinated for, 6 to 8 hours a day for at least 12 years. Otherwise, you're stupid.
I have heard a lot of people make that argument, actually.
Yeah, so if you get homeschooled or if you get any kind of schooling that's not a government school, for instance, a charter school or a private school, you're just stupid. You have to get the government schooling, or you can't get any intelligence.
Yeah, I'd like to. I've been thinking about seeing if I could be a part of or just do it myself, opening a school here based on the Ron Paul curriculum. Maybe we could only have kids for 2 or 4 hours a day and see if we could turn out some smarties. I don't know if that's possible or not.
I'm not sure that would be legal. I'm not sure the state would allow you to do that.
I don't know. I haven't even looked into that part of it. Hey, would it be the state stopping me, or would it be people in general stopping me?
Well, I think that people might look for their... I'm sure someone out there would think there ought to be a law to prevent someone like you from educating children, even your own, and that they would probably attempt to get a law passed, and then once they have the state on their side, then they'll turn you in.
Yeah, they'd stop me from being utopian.
I wish people could see the grin on your face when you say words like that and the obvious sarcasm with which you say them.
I just don't understand why we can't have a utopia. Why can't we? Why can't Fairbanks anyway? I mean, I understand that the possibility of it being on a grand scale of all of America, sure, that's probably not very probable to get everybody in America to come to the realization that they're involved in raping each other. But what about right here in Fairbanks? I mean, people come to Alaska for you know, the pioneering type reasons. We should be a different breed of people up here. Instead, it seems like we're the most socialistic of them all. You know, give us more, give us more. It's like running back on the haul road. This, 2 hours ago, I was still on the haul road and getting the crap beat out of me by how ridiculously bad the road is, and I couldn't help but think to myself, if it wasn't federally funded, if it wasn't stolen money, you know, all the people here in Alaska rely, they don't rely, sorry, but they all expect to get some of the money of what goes on up there. But how many people are actually being a producer in that area? Well, the people running that road are. They're the lifeblood of everything that goes on up there. And they can't even keep the road maintained. It's the worst road in the world. It's horrible. And it's not because the road's dangerous. It's because the road's crap. Because the state doesn't maintain it. They get paid to maintain it, but they do such a poor job, it's embarrassing. I don't even know anybody that runs that road that doesn't basically have a distaste for state workers just because they have to drive on that road. And everybody screams and screams for their share of that pie, but how many people are concerned with the road that's being driven on? But if it was free enterprise, how nice do you think that road would be? How nice do you think that the oil company would keep that road? And there, I mean, there's your answer to everybody's, the classic libertarian question, but who will build the roads? Well, of course, obviously, necessity would build the road.
Well, if you look back a little over 100 years ago to what was happening on the East Coast with the railroads, and back in the 1880s, 1890s, up through about the 1910s or so, the East Coast was riddled with railroads from private lines. People were building their own railroads to be able to transport their goods from the manufacturing out to the warehouse or out to the docks. And there were so many of them being built.
Or in the case of Rockefeller, build his own pipeline.
This was being done with private money, not with government money. And what happened? What happened to that? It wasn't out of control capitalism that crashed it. It was monopolies that were created by government interference that crashed it. It was the government getting involved in the private enterprise and partnering up with a couple of their few select buddies, giving them, well, basically monopolies, giving them the special certificate of need or whatever else you want to call it.
Exactly. I mean, everybody calls what Josh and I talk about on this show utopian, but why do people think that there has to be force for things to happen? I mean, it's like, take business in general, the regulation of business. People, you know, fear that if the government wasn't there to regulate business, what would we do? But doesn't, how can you sit there and think, especially with today's technology, that the market wouldn't take care of that itself? Let's use Angie's List as an example. How many people to go onto a government website to go find out which business is the best one to do business with? How many people go on Angie's List to do the same, to do that? Of course, everybody's going to go to Angie's List. You're not going to go to some government.org website. What would regulate business more? Something like Angie's List or government regulation that strangles the businessman? And that's an easy answer. Anybody can answer that question. Obviously, something like Angie's List, because people would go out of business. You don't need theft and force to have a civilized society.
You know, you're asking about what would stop us from having a utopia even here in Fairbanks. And I think, Aaron, that part of the problem is that people look at the other organizations that they're a part of, whether it's their local church or whether it's their local Elks Club or their local VFW, and they see the internal politics and they see the power struggles that happen behind the scenes, and they see the vicious way in which people treat each other, people that supposedly like each other or are supposed to love each other. They see it in their own families. They see the way that people are just downright rotten and evil to each other. And I don't know if it's because people aren't willing to make it work in the smallest scale, even in their own family.
I think it's actually the other way around, Steve. You can't make the case that people left to themselves are tyrants to each other, because you look around and you see it every day in every interaction that you make. People interact sociably for their own benefit. Of course, there's always asocial individuals, but government isn't regulating what you do on a day-to-day. to the point where, you know, you think about, well, you're just at the VA thing, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or because there wasn't somebody in a uniform standing there, was everybody chopping each other's heads off?
No, they were not.
Right, so the only time where you think, where you can make the argument that government is required or people will just be each other's wolves and eat each other, is that this unknown number of people. It's always the unknown, because everybody you know is decent. But there's these people that you don't know that are beyond the realm of your immediate contacts that you tell yourself in your mind need to be regulated. But your everyday life proves it wrong.
No, I think you missed my point, though, Aaron. My point was is that I think that there are people that I do know, and that there are people that you probably know as well in your interactions that are just plain jackasses.
Right. Well, without any socialism at all, how many of those people would be jackasses?
You mean if they didn't have a power structure with which to exert themselves?
Oh, well, ostracism would work and always has worked. If you're an asocial individual, you're ostracized. The only thing the government does is sanction bad behavior.
Yeah, that's a hotline. You want to see who's on the hotline?
Yeah, morning? Sure.
458-TALK is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Jim in Kenai.
Hey, Jim. How are you?
Doing well. Sorry I didn't make it last week. Jim and Nikiski called in. But yeah, doing well.
Close enough. Hey, I wanted to thank you for the arguments that you made on my Facebook page this week.
Oh, I'm always happy to be argumentative.
No, it's not argumentative. It was arguments. It was good, solid logic that you were using, and unfortunately some of my statist friends are not capable of.
You have statist friends?
I have a lot of statist friends.
Well, happy to partake. So I think Aaron's point is that, you know, disassociation is one of the very important freedom. It's in the First Amendment. The First Amendment recognizes it, that we have the right to associate and also to disassociate. And if you disassociate with people, that's a way of maintaining peace, because they can no longer, that minimizes their effect on you. But the state and the government forces us to associate with people we don't want to. So we're constantly put in conflict with people who we have disagreements with, because they're also part of the state. The state's community, and so we're forced into contact with them. We're forced into combating with them in order to preserve what's ours, and that doesn't. That's not how the church is organized. One of the the main way the church had discipline was to disassociate from people who walked unruly. So I think,
and that's a very good point, Jim. That even within the scriptural references that so many people that are in the so-called conservative circles. They like to quote scripture at each other, but in those very same scriptures, one of the ways that in which you handled somebody who was being argumentative, the way that you handled somebody who was being disruptive, the way that you handled somebody who was leading others astray, the way that you handled somebody who was thieving, is that you shunned them. You put them out of fellowship. You didn't kill them.
You didn't cage them.
You didn't cage them. You didn't beat them publicly. You didn't exercise force on them. You put them out of the fellowship.
Right, but for your everyday statist, the biggest argument made, obviously, is always, what about national defense? And for somebody that hasn't read something like Market for Liberty or Myth of National Defense, which everyone that has those questions should go read, because they're amazing. Both of those are really amazing books that answer those type of questions. But you know, for the sake of somebody that's not going to do that, just listen to the show. I mean, how do you wrap your mind around the reality of not needing this monstrosity of a military that we have? Or even the monstrosity of the law enforcement we have here?
Well, those two are becoming so intertwined, it's almost impossible to separate the two anymore.
Of course they are, and why wouldn't they?
Well, doesn't the Constitution kind of say that they're not supposed to?
I don't think the Constitution says anything about policing powers not becoming military powers and so on and so forth. The Constitution is pretty much whatever you want to make it into, because the people made it, and the people accept what is.
Right. Well, we got the separation through posse comitatus after the war between the states, in recognition of just how awful Reconstruction was. So that's not really posse. I don't know if that's really in the Constitution. I'd have to think back. But the federal government supporting local policing has really turned local policing into the federal government's occupying army. So.
Right, and posse comitatus came about because the military was basically being a police force in the mm-hmm. northern states. They were actually going way beyond that. They were openly plundering people.
See, it's sort of like civil forfeiture?
Pretty much. I mean, I don't know. I don't even know where to go with it, Jim, really. But basically, I guess what I'm trying to say is a place like Fairbanks, of all the places where people think a certain way, why not Fairbanks? Why do we have to have this system of theft, this system of violence? Why do we have to believe that we have to use force on each other? Why do the people I interact with that admit these things are wrong still delve into them so deeply and don't even consider that there isn't, I mean, even in people that know they're an alternative, don't even consider that it's viable?
That's a good question. That's, part of what I hoped to find up here when I moved was a more independent spirit and a more cooperative spirit as opposed to what was developing in Texas.
Sure, and that's what I was hoping to find up here too, but it actually, when I lived in Idaho, I think it was a lot more favorable to these type of ideas than this place has been. And I don't know if it's because the state gives us free money. Everybody has this mentality of entitlement up here. I mean, it's not just free money in the form of the dividends. Denali Kid Care. Any woman up here can get a free phone. More or less. And they take care of you from birth to 18 through the Denali Kid Care program. Anybody that can't afford a dentist, before I became a hardline anarchist myself, I got my teeth fixed twice. The government paid for it. I had a job. It never even crossed my mind that I was stealing from somebody else. I mean, I, this state, in my opinion, when you interact with people, has the biggest gimme attitude anywhere. And people move here because this is the last frontier. I always used to say this is the last frontier for the working man. And I still believe that. I mean, people come here to be a worker and make money doing it, make good money doing it. But somehow, once we're here, we develop this attitude that we're owed something by the state itself.
Isn't a lot of that from the fact that we get handed a share of the oil profits that we had nothing to do with bringing in? I mean, you look at you talk to some of the old timers, the people that were here before the pipeline. Talk to the people that were here before they started dishing out the permanent fund. Those people came up here, they eked out their own survival, they scratched their living out of the dirt, whether they were mining or hunting or trapping or logging, fishing, whatever they were doing. They came up here with that mentality of, I'm coming here to make a new life for myself. And nobody owes me anything. I'm going to work for myself. You talk to the old timers. They had that attitude. Something changed about the same time that we started handing out free money for living here.
It's not just through the dividend, like I'm saying. Most of the people I know everyone I know takes advantage of all the other ways that they take care of you up here, especially Denali Kid Care.
I think Steve's meaning that the lure of the money changed the character of the people. It brought in a different character of people, and it seduced the people who are here.
Sure, once you involve yourself in theft, it's pretty hard to break out of it.
Yeah.
Just like once you delve so far into force, it's really hard to break out of it. You know, I talked to people like Maria Renzel. She agrees with me all the time about how the system doesn't work and how it's corrupt. And I know in her heart that she believes that there is a better way that doesn't involve force, but she daily involves herself in force. and refuses to give it up? Is it because you can become so deep in it that, I mean, it's like it takes possession of you? People don't want to give up, especially, I've noticed, the Christian right, my Christian friends, way more than my secular friends, don't even want to entertain the thought of not being able to force, or at least, I mean, have a chance to force morals. I mean, they'll vehemently say, well, we have to have government. Otherwise, people will, I mean, all these liberals will just take over and everybody will just be making love in the streets and have long hair.
Says the man with no hair.
Says the man with, see, I'm not a hippie. That's why we have Claudio on all the time, so nobody can call me a racist. Equal opportunity employer here. But, I mean, I guess I'm just... And we all think we want to see results in our lifetime. And I think that's what contributes so much to politics, especially on the right, is they want to see results in their lifetime. And if that involves using force, then they'll do it.
Not realizing that deep six is the whole point of making progress.
Right.
It's self undercutting.
So... I don't know if I need to change my time preference here and think maybe my posterity will have a chance at a more enlightened people. But it's just, you know, we come on here so much, and I spend so much of my life, not just on this show, but, you know, getting out there and trying to spread the message that human beings can live without theft and force on each other. And it always seems like an uphill battle all the time. Is there any ray of hope in that? Can people come to the realization that they can all be free together? That we don't need this borough building? We don't need people to be taxed on their own property? We don't need a force of police going around enforcing regulation, taking money from you, wrecking lives? We don't need... a commission for every single thing in our life. We don't need a regulation on everything that we do. Every aspect of business is so far regulated that most people can't even start a business. What have we done to ourselves? We're insane.
And again, speaking of insanity, we keep on expecting that things are going to change if we just vote in the right people.
Right, well, we're voting in people, asking them to use more force. How does anybody justify that in their own mind?
I don't think the right people will run. I mean, if you really think about it, it'd be like asking a priest to go and join the mafia in order to get the mafia to change.
Right, but I have to lean really hard with Josh there. And who's this man anyway, that or woman for that matter, that can rule me better than me?
Yeah.
I mean, Jim. Maybe if we voted in Jim, he could rule me better than me. I don't know. I seriously doubt it.
Do you think that you could rule Aaron better than Aaron could?
I doubt it.
I doubt it because you don't know my wants, my needs, my social structure, my home life. You don't know the way that I raise my family. You don't know what I like to do for fun. Even our fun is regulated. Every aspect of our fun, you name something that's fun to do, and I'll tell you how it's regulated. We can't even go have fun in Fairbanks, Alaska, without having to pay fealty to the state for doing it. There's something wrong with that. We are sick, and we do it to each other. It's not like, you know, especially the far right wingers, they have this illusion that this boogeyman government is doing all this to them. We're doing it to each other, because tomorrow we could have a free Fairbanks. Tomorrow. Everybody could stop using force on each other and agree to stop government. And just like that, everyone would be free. Everyone would be out in the street eating each other.
only if they get a hold of that, what's that stuff, spice? No, bath salts. That's the stuff there on the street that causes people to act like zombies and eat each other's brains.
I just want you to know, Steve, if Fairbanks ever goes anarchist, I'm eating you first.
Well, there's not as much of me left as there used to be. I don't think I would go that far.
Well, it's interesting that Karen DeCoster talks a lot about Detroit and about how, you know, the media shows the same collapsing areas. And it's not like there isn't really a problem there, but the government is broken, and what there is of it is ineffectual. So people are solving their own problems, and it's having a comeback. So, you know, if Fairbanks could just run out of money, you might actually have your utopia.
What kind of a crazy person are you, Jim?
I know.
To suggest that we would
That's
be...
That's what people ask all the time.
We wouldn't have a utopia, though. I don't agree with that. And the reason is because people have to come to that realization independently of being forced into it by catastrophe. I hear a lot of anarchists talk about how catastrophe will bring about the results they want, and I really don't think it will. Liberty and freedom are a state of mind.
Well, I agree with that. But once there's no longer a crutch to lean on, you know...
But Jim, once there's no longer a crutch, the patient falls over. But once the patient hits the ground, he's still going to be thinking, all I need is for somebody to help me back up.
And
if you look at what happened right after the American Revolution, how many people asked George Washington to become king?
Not the majority of them.
No, but it certainly enough that it was entered into the history books.
Oh, sure.
Right. I think the biggest thing to me that I would fear about having a monetary collapse, that all the anarchists laud as being the biggest hope for anarchy, is two things would happen, in my opinion, is people would raise up a new form of government, much more closer to home, much more tyrannical. And number two, you would get the anarchy that everybody fears.
The violence and the...
The violence chaos. And the chaos and the death, because people, just because government leaves, they're still going to want theirs.
I won't argue with that. It's just the, a lot of people flee. The thing with it being Detroit, a lot of the worst people left Detroit. There's no longer that system for theft, so it has to be private theft, and private theft, you bear the consequences of that yourself. So.
Hey, Jim, can you stay on the line?
Sure.
All right, you've got it on Patriots Lament on KFAR.
Don't touch that dial. Fox News is here on KFAR.
Fox News Radio, I'm Lillian Wu. Hundreds killed this week in Egypt. Now the government forces are trying to round up supporters of the deposed president.
Part of those roundups, Mohammed al-Zawahiri. If the name sounds familiar, it's because his brother, Ayman, is the leader of al-Qaeda.
Fox's Leland Vittard says there's evidence the Islamists are getting outside help.
Just in the past couple of hours, there was a car bombing at the Egyptian consulate in Benghazi, Libya. We know a number of al-Qaeda-affiliated groups have been able to operate inside Libya, and this may be the first opening salvo of what could turn into a much larger armed insurrection, something like a car bombing, some kind of civil war starts to brew.
And here at home, 5 months after a Georgia toddler was killed in his stroller by a gunshot, the teen charged as the gunman is set to stand trial. Jury selection slated to begin Monday. Fox News, we report, you decide.
Say what's on your mind. Talk about it on Local News Radio, 660.
Local News the Spirit, where the Spirit of the Lord is now, there is liberty, and the Spirit lives inside of me, where the Spirit of the Lord is now, there is liberty. There is liberty. There is liberty. For freedom, you set me free. Yes, I am free indeed. You rewrote my name, a shackle, my shame. You opened my eyes to see. I am free.
And welcome back to Patriots Lament right here on KFAR. It's local talk radio, 660 on your AM dial, but online at KFAR660.com and on Facebook as well. I am Steve Floyd, the monkey behind the machine. Joining us here in the studio, we've got Aaron Bennett. Good morning, Aaron.
Good morning, Steve.
And joining us on the phone, we've got Jim from Kenai. Good morning, Jim.
Good morning.
All right.
I wanted to mention that I have my oldest boy, Elijah, here.
Is he going to say hello?
Yeah, he's going to say hello.
Go ahead, say hello. There we go. Elijah, good to have you here in the studio with us.
He just finished reading Whatever Happened to Penny Candy and just started...
Whatever Happened to Justice.
Who's that by?
I forgot.
Same guy as Whatever Happened to Penny Candy.
I think so.
Right?
It's not important who wrote it.
No, I'm just kidding. I'm having
Richard Mayberry wrote that. He's been a guest on the show a couple times.
Really?
Yeah, really. Oh. Pretty crazy, huh?
You know, I found a copy of Whatever Happened to Penny Candy there on my wife's side of the bed. She's out of town this week. I'm Mr. Mom, right? So I'm taking care of the kids. And one of the kids managed to spill water on her side of the bed. And so I was cleaning it up. And hey, here's a copy of Whatever Happened to Penny Candy. And it's been dog-eared. Apparently my wife has been reading it. She didn't know. I mean, she didn't tell me.
Well, good.
She's reading on her own.
She's going to school you in
about
a week.
I know. It's going to be awesome. All right. Hey, before the break, you guys were talking about this issue of basically the statist and why does people think that they need the state and what we would do with police, without police, with anything that we think of national defense. What about people, and maybe I can kind of dovetail on this, people who claim that they want limited government, but then they turn around and ask for more money for national defense.
All right, well, I argue with limited government types all the time. They're my favorite ones to argue with because they tend to think they think like me until we start to argue. The argument for limited government is the same argument for global government. And that's pretty much it in a nutshell. If you're going to argue for limited government, I can make the same use your argument to argue for a worldwide one world government.
How so? I mean, take me through that because I...
Hey, whatever excuse you have for the necessity of government, for having
any,
to have it.
For any government at all, even just, but you're
right,
saying
I'm gonna argue,
we need some, but we're just going to have a little teeny tiny little bit. Just
the reason that you have for having that teeny tiny bit, for retaining that little bit of force and theft, legalized plunder, I can make the same argument for having a global government because the argument's exactly the same.
It's just the scale.
Well, absolutely. Go ahead.
There's anarchy between the states, you know. So the international order exists in a state of anarchy. So if you need a little bit of government to handle you and your buddies, you need a government to handle the anarchy between the states.
You're right, because there's nobody governing the way that Canada and the United States and Mexico act toward each other.
Exactly.
And that's why we have the Canadians invading New York City, even as we speak.
Well, sure they do.
All right. Well, we have had the United States invade Mexico.
And Canada.
And Canada.
Oh.
We invaded Canada in the Revolutionary War, actually.
So wait a second. So what you're saying is the United States is actually an aggressor nation?
In 1812. We tried to take over Canada in 1812.
Why did we invade... here's a little quiz for you. Why did we invade Canada in the Revolutionary War? Anybody know?
Bueller? Anybody?
Jim?
No, I don't know.
Because King George extended the Canadians religious freedom, and we weren't about to have that. We weren't about to have universal religious freedom in Canada because it was predominantly Catholic. So we invaded them. There's your patriotic lover of religious freedom for you.
Oh, my goodness. Well, I you see that, though, in a lot of the colonies. In Massachusetts, there was basically a religious test, wasn't there, in order to
mm-hmm.
hold any kind of state office? And in Virginia, even, wasn't there? I mean, you had to, and it was Thomas Jefferson writing the Virginian Bill of Rights that really kind of helped get rid of the requirement for a religious test, right? Am I getting this right?
I don't know. I know that it's not surprising to me that we ended up with this type of state that we did here in America, considering the religious zeal that was present in the colonies, because Christianity, at least the Reformation Christianity, was the birthplace of the state as we know it today. If it wasn't for the Reformation and the throwing down of monarchies and the rise of universal suffrage and the rise of the state and all powerful kings, state kings. State kings came about because of the Reformation. The greats, Calvin, Luther, mass murderers, at least Luther was.
We keep thinking that it's the laws who make the bad states. We don't realize that the state is just problematic because of what it is. It can't be run correctly by Christians either.
No, it can't. I think Luther, who was one of the founders of the first states, helped found it anyway. He proved that.
You mean the state of Germany, not like the
right,
state of Virginia?
The state of Germany. He was instrumental in the process of bringing the. Well, Germany had what? Over 250 fiefdoms during the time of Luther, and it went down to. There was very few by the time he was done, because he spent his life centralizing power and bringing it all under one state. And it's no different than the right today. They use the state to try and force a moral. And that's also when we got the first compulsory education systems was through Luther and Calvin, because they wanted to make sure that the morals were enforced via the school system. It was all anti-Catholicism, which I'm totally cool with, except for the using force to get their part.
Even the public school system here, I mean, fast forward to the 1820s, 1830s, a lot of the laws that were passed in the United States for compulsory public education had to do with the fact that these doggone Catholics were educating their children to be good Catholics instead of to be good American statists.
Well, good Protestants.
Well, that's the point. Is that if you are loyal to the Catholic religion, then you have a higher allegiance than to your state.
Your state can't do anything it wants to
do
with you.
Exactly, exactly. The state cannot order you to go out and do something that your God tells you you cannot do.
Right, I kind of feel like we're going down the same road we always go to, and we always go to the easy road, which is to point out how ridiculous the state is. And I kind of wanted to. Maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm too tired to go this route this time, but I'd like to talk about some of the viable alternatives. Obviously there is some. Men that are much more educated than me have written books about them. But, for all the people that think it's utopian, isn't anything that's even remotely viable preferable over to legalized plunder at the threat of death?
I would sure think so. And, the idea of why can't Fairbanks be free, I think it's a good question. I think, and the problem is so long as there's that mechanism of robbing those who have more than you to satisfy your own needs, it's hard to people really don't want to admit that it's theft so long as it's benefiting them so much.
But even without the mechanism, Jim, you think about it, if we took the mechanism away, I can tell you at least a dozen, and a number of them were associated with one particular fellow who is now in jail. Every time they talked about when the federal government collapses, when the state government collapses, we need to make our own new government. Over and over, they kept on saying that.
Yeah, well, because of the store that I owned, I would say that that's pretty much the general consensus in your right-wingers, is the new government that they all dream of. They all have their own version of it, but Steve's absolutely right. I've said it on this show for couple, what, 4 or 5 years, when I first started coming on with Steve, I would argue with guys that were, oh, we just need to have the revolution. I was like, and what? Your guys' idea is always to set up this new government.
Exactly. So the best possible world is the city, the Fairbanks borough building stays there, but can't do anything except prevent somebody from setting up another Fairbanks borough building. So if it were to be there and holding, it's, it would be kind of like the king who spends all his time, you know, playing with his toy soldiers, but not actually doing much.
Yes. Yes.
Then it's almost better to have a do-nothing monarch, because that then people think they're governed, but they're really not, because he's not doing anything. That would almost be better.
Well, think about it like this. I would be okay if we got rid of all forms of government and just had the borough building only, because every eye would be on them. Every single eye. Nobody would look to any other fault, any other blame. Obama would be gone. Glenn Beck would go off the air. Thank God. And everybody would just be looking at this borough building, and they would change the way they act immediately. I bet our tax rate would go down to basically nothing overnight.
Well, the federal government wouldn't be funneling money into Fairbanks through the borough building, so the borough building would have to they'd become essentially a monarch, right? They'd have to do things which were economically advantageous, which would mean liberty.
Exactly. And, you know, and to reach that point, you don't have to tell the federal government. I mean, you don't have to go march on the federal building. Let them keep it. Let them keep running it. Just, they don't have any jurisdiction outside of the federal building. They can keep that thing and burn fuel in it all winter long. We'll sell them the fuel.
That's why, you know, people get all bent out of shape about how Don Young has been in office, and, you know, as a representative of Alaska for... what's he approaching, like 3,000 years now, right? I mean, but seriously, it's been like since 1970.
Okay.
He's been in office, and people are, oh, we need term limits. We need to get new, fresh blood in there. Look at what Don Young has accomplished in the last 2 years, since his last term. Wait, how much has he accomplished? Not a whole heck of a lot. Good. We need more people like Don Young who are more concerned with getting fat and lazy and profiting on their own little personal side deals.
The problem with term limits is the problem with free elected government officials in the first place. All it does is make the person that's in the position to steal less calculated. The less time he has, the more violent he will be, the more theft he will be involved in. Because he can't, he has no incentive to be any other way. If you put a limit on how long they can be in office, where's the limit to their self-control?
They do whatever time frame you put on it. If you only have 2 years in office, then you only have 2 years to make yourself rich.
Right, so the only reason that people want term limits is because they're so far gone in the head that they just want to be able to switch for the good man faster. We just need a good man. That way they can say it even faster than they were saying it before. So instead of every 4 years, it's every 2 years they can say, this time we're going to get in a good man. Next thing, we should just have an election every week. Because this time we'll get in a good man. We'll just go through them so fast.
Except that when you finally do get a good man... And, well, oh, gee, it's time for him to get out. Term limits.
Yeah, right. What would we have done if Ron Paul had 2 terms? I mean, you know, for the liberty movement, who thinks that would have worked? What would that have done to Ron Paul? He never would have had the time to build up the national base of people and create the platform he did for speaking anti-statism.
Right, and if Ron Paul would have got elected, he would have been dead in a week anyway. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah. But I think... Barack Obama is a case in point that the president has very little power. The bureaucracy has a whole lot of power, and the bureaucracy is gigantic.
Right. The silliest thing I see is all the stuff on Facebook where people blame Barack Obama for everything. I mean, I've started to get on board with it. It's been working out pretty good at home, you know. Little boys get their clothes muddy. Are you guys around Barack Obama again? I told you not to hang out with him. Yeah, he's the boogeyman for everything. It's the worst I've ever seen with any president. You know, I'm only 34 years old, but I've been through a couple presidents, and I've never seen anything like Barack Obama. He's great. The biggest scapegoat of all time. He's definitely the boogeyman.
My father, God bless him, he blames Barack Obama for things that Richard Nixon did in office. honestly, blaming Barack Obama for getting off the gold standard? Dad, seriously, wow. That happened under Nixon. Nixon did that, not Barack Obama. You know, and people blame Barack Obama for things that the Congress did. You know, look at the welfare thing, that people are blaming Barack Obama for the explosion in welfare. How about blaming the people that are applying for welfare?
And the Congress that passes it.
The Congress that passes it.
That's the biggest thing. The power is vested in Congress to pass law. The power is vested in them to levy tax, not Barack Obama. We just need a good man, Jim. I think that's what it is. We need a good man right here in Fairbanks to stand up and lead everybody to liberty.
Well, you know, it's funny. If we got that good man, what he'd do is say, deal with your problems yourself. I'm shutting down the building. And then people would be unhappy with that. The people who elected the good man and say, no, we wanted you to rule. Just rule right.
Right, exactly. You know, the funniest argument to me is just to say, you know, I'll use Hans Hoppe. I quote him all the time when I start to get into a pretty deep argument with a statist. Is a tax-funded protection agency is a contradiction in terms. How much more simpler can it get than that? An agency that you elect to protect you, that steals from you to protect you, is a contradiction in the contract that you're making, the social contract.
That's so abstract.
I mean, I don't understand why people can't grasp that. That the only reason that people institute government is for protection of private property. But for them to protect your private property, they steal it. And the more that government sticks around, and the more people that it gets involved, the more universal suffrage it has. It adds the women, adds the blacks, on and on and on. The more people realize that they can vote themselves money, the more grabbing there becomes, and the less protected your private property is.
All of the energy gets concentrated on being one of the grabbers instead of one of the victims.
Right. Even the most harmless guy on the planet involves himself vehemently in politics because he has to. You know, I'll agree with we had a guest on a little while ago. His name's slipping me. What was our guest 2 weeks ago? Or was it last week?
You know what?
Not Walter Block.
Yeah, Walter Block. Yeah. When he was talking about voting as self-defense. I don't agree with him, but I think that people participate in politics out of self-defense. Absolutely.
Sure.
And just the fact that anybody would make the claim that you need to be involved in politics out of self-defense is an argument to say that we need to get rid of government. Are you kidding me? If you have to be actively defending yourself from this tyranny, why would you want to keep it? And it's just like the tax cap. We go crazy every year over the tax cap up here. Why don't we get rid of the dang building or the people that run it? Why are we letting these people steal from us and then fighting over how much they're going to steal? It's the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
Talk is the number. We've got three lines on hold. What would you like to do with them?
Go ahead.
All right, let's go.
We'll let
phone.
Jim tear them up.
Good morning, caller. They didn't hold. How about you? Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Frank.
Frank, what's on your mind today?
Well, a while back, about a week or so ago, you talked about the secret ballot, and you guys kind of put it down. Well, I'll give you an idea that took place that I've personally experienced with. Back in '64, I worked for Anaconda in Butte, Montana, in the deep copper mines. And I was a Barry Goldwater Republican, and I had my Goldwater Miller sticker on my windshield. And people were threatening me as a strict, staunch Union town. We'll run you off the road. And then other people threatened me and said, oh, my brother, while I was here, we'd throw you down the manway. And I'm serious. And I had to be a member of the Mine, Mill, and Smelters Workers Union. And they intimidated that whole town, so you better toe the line. People had, like, with axe on their windshield, your kids are next.
Can I ask you a question?
What?
Do you think that the instrument of force should be legal at all?
What do you mean by that? I don't quite follow.
Wouldn't the better alternative, instead of having a secret ballot, so we secretly use force on each other, wouldn't the better alternative to not have that application of force accessible at all?
Well, I think there's a certain element called human nature that you are not going to overcome by law or without law. It is present in the psyche of the species.
I agree. Given the chance, human nature, we will be parasitical and we will rob each other blind. Given the opportunity, which the state provides that opportunity on a scale never seen in history before.
Well, my only way to stick with the ballot, it's like the Black Panthers using intimidation in the election back a while ago.
Yeah, but the state's the problem with all that, not the people. People themselves aren't the problem. Without the state, would there be the Black Panthers?
Well, there are always going to be thugs that try to harass people to follow their will or else. By one method or means. The government does it through its manipulation, through regulation, to where stifled half to death. I went down to the Department of Conservation. I have a little place built here in Enactor for my wife about the septic system. And they handed me a stack of papers about a half inch thick full of legalese to whip. Everybody used to have an outhouse. None had left hardly in Enactor. And so you hook into the city system or else. Well, I'm not going to do that.
Right, but hang on one second here. You're saying that there's always going to be asocial individuals, correct?
There are people that will try to impose their will, yes.
Right, but only the state makes it sanctioned, okay? Just because you're somebody that's asocial, you're somebody that given the chance, would rob somebody, that's considered to be someone that is an outlaw, someone that's outside of the law, right?
Yes.
With the state apparatus, it's the only institution where you're inside the law to do the same things that you're talking about.
So, I understand, absolutely.
So let's not use the argument, you know, that because there's asocial individuals, the necessity of an entity of a monopoly of force and violence, same thing, I guess. The monopoly of violence and theft is what I meant, is required.
Makes brutality legal, in whether it was Nazi Germany or ancient Rome, it doesn't matter.
Exactly. So the only viable answer is to not have a state at all and just let...
I don't think that'll work. I mean, it sounds good in theory and people can philosophize about it.
But didn't you just make the argument? You're defeating your own argument. I mean, you just made the argument that government is the only time that asocial individuals are not frowned upon.
Well, personally, I'm kind of an anarchist at heart and soul and spirit, and have been for a long time. So I try to stay out of its grasp. It's like I won't conform to their little system. We'll use a porta potty, and I'll use one of these, what they call a blue boy, and I'll deal with our human waste, and I won't get into their system. But we don't live on the road anyway. This is a retirement place for my wife, and it'll never be used for hope many years till I'm dead and gone.
Jim?
Jim, you have something to say?
No, I think Aaron's saying all the right points. The antisocial people have a higher advantage of getting hold of the state than the social people do, because the gentleman, I understand where he's coming from, but it can't work. It's a self-defeating argument.
Well, and right. I think that the unions are a perfect example of what is going on with the voting, because everybody recognizes that it's wrong for people in a union to come in and force other people to be a part of a union if they don't want to be.
But we do it every day with voting.
But we do it every day with voting, exactly.
Right, and there's always going to be somebody in power is kind of one of the arguments you were making, but let's take a monarchy, just... I'll hit on it real quick. We'll take the next call. But with a monarchy, you have one person. One person. So he's looked upon he's the only person that can legally covet another man's property and steal from him. The only person. No one else can. So everybody looks at every move he makes with suspicion. And I personally think that that's why the highest tax rate that I've been able to find in my studying was 3%. In post-state societies, which would be monarcho societies. There might be. I'm not saying there wasn't any higher tax rates than 3%, but the highest I've found is 3%. And how much do we pay right now? And I'm just talking what they directly take from you. Most of the lower 48 people pay 40% of their income. That is slavery. And that's not including the millions of other taxes you pay.
All right, did you want to try to squeeze in another call? We got about a minute here. 458 Talk, the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Randy.
Randy, what's on your mind?
Well, last week, I think it was, I brought up the thought that I would not mind seeing a small capitalistic anarchal enclave set up here in Alaska, and I had set up a few conditions. I thought that, well, we can regulate immigration coming in so some foreign entity doesn't set up shop there, and also the local authorities, the troopers, could go into the enclave to search for a fugitive that had created a crime outside of the enclave. And there's some other little considerations.
Why couldn't we have insurance companies do the exact same thing? Where, because they would be much more cooperative with each other for the obvious the monetary reasons, they would want, and they would actually have a vested interest for justice instead of a vested interest for their own personal gain. If you had insurance companies doing exactly what you're talking about, the monetary reasons behind it would produce justice, where the state can't, and not only can't it, it won't.
Yeah, the inside the enclave, the insurance companies could do what.
No. All together, insurance could cover the problem that you're talking about.
In the enclave,
they're actually the only entity that could do what you're talking about justly.
All right, we're up against the clock here. We got the Fox News at the top of the hour. Make sure we get our good government-sponsored propaganda for the day. You've got it on Patriots Lament right here on KFAR, local talk radio. If you'd like to get in queue, the number is 458-TALK, 458-8255.
Talk radio for the interior, 660 AM, KFAR. Unfold. News Talk 660 KFAR.
If you love wealth better than liberty, the tranquility of servitude better than the animating contest of freedom, go from us in peace. We ask not your counsels or your arms. Crouch down and lick the hands which feed you. May your chains set lightly upon you, and may posterity forget that you were our countrymen. Samuel Adams.
The time is near at hand, which must determine whether Americans are to be free men or slaves. George Washington.
And what country can preserve its liberties if its rulers are not warned from time to time that this people preserve the spirit of resistance? Let them take arms. The tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. Thomas Jefferson.
Posterity, you will never know how much it costs the present generation to preserve your freedom. I hope you will make good use of it. If you do not, I shall repent in heaven that ever I took half the pains to preserve it. John Adams.
I sincerely believe that banking establishments are more dangerous than standing armies, and that the principle of spending money to be paid by posterity under the name of funding is but swindling futurity on a large scale. Thomas Jefferson.
Government is instituted to protect property, this being the end of government. That alone is a just government, which impartially secures to every man whatever is his own. That is not a just government, nor is property secure under it, where arbitrary restrictions, exceptions, and monopolies deny to part of its citizens the free use of their own faculties. James Madison.
It would be an absurdity for jurors to be required to accept the judge's view of the law against their own opinion, judgment, and conscience. John Adams.
Whenever the legislators endeavor to take away and destroy the property of the people, or to reduce them to slavery under arbitrary power, they put themselves into a state of war with the people, who are thereupon absolved from any further obedience, and are left to the common refuge which God hath provided for all men against force and violence. John Locke.
It is in vain, sir, to extenuate the matter. Gentlemen may cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace. The war is actually begun. The next gale that sweeps from the north will bring to our ears the clash of resounding arms. Our brethren are already in the field. Why stand we here, idle? What is it that gentlemen wish? What would they have? Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but for me, give me liberty or give me death. Patrick Henry.
My people perish for the lack of knowledge. God.
Welcome to Patriots Lament right here on KFAR. We are local talk radio, 660 on your AM dial, online at KFAR660.com. I am Steve Floyd, the button pusher, basically the trained monkey here working for a few bananas to make sure that the message gets out there, because you know what, you can't stop the signal. Joining us here in the studio, we've got Aaron Bennett. Good morning, Aaron.
Good morning, Steve.
We've also got his spawn of Bennett over here, Elijah. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
And we've also got some foreigner on the other side there.
Good morning, habanero.
Good morning, habanero. All right. We were talking a little bit in the break here in terms of monetary policies and the way in which people work. Basically, they're almost slaves now for what they earn. I want to quiz the youngster a little bit here and see what he knows about economics.
I've only read one book so far.
Well, then you know what? That's good enough. That Whatever Happened to Penny Candy is a phenomenal explanation of basic money. Basically, and I want to see if you get this. If I tell you I want you to go out and mow my lawn for $5, and you agree to do that, and I pay you $5, five American dollar bills for mowing my lawn today, and then you come back next week, and the government has injected more money into the system. They've had yet another
quantitative easing,
whatever they want to call it. Basically, they're injecting more monies in, and I say I'm going to still pay you $5. To mow the lawn. Am I actually paying you the same amount of money?
No.
Why not?
Because the government, because the value of our money is going down.
So you're telling me that the value of the actual money is going down because they're injecting more money into the system?
Yes.
How does that work?
Inflation.
Who's been, obviously, you didn't teach this child to read, Aaron. What's going on? I'm teasing you. Obviously, you've done something.
I think, something that Josh has pointed out many times, people need to get their mind around this, and we're kind of going away from where we were, but I'll just put it out there really quick. Junk silver is worth about $4.25 right now. It's worth about, it's a 25 cent piece of junk silver is worth $4.25 American, and a gallon of gas in the 1960s cost 25 cents when they made the junk silver. And today, a gallon of gas costs $4.25. So the price of gasoline actually has not changed since the 60s. Not one bit. Your money's became worth less. So when people like Lisa Pager call up here and say we need to regulate these gas companies, they got to bring the price of gas down. They actually haven't changed the price of it at all. They've become more efficient at getting it out. Technically, it's cheaper than it was by about 10 cents, which would be by about 3 cents. It's cheaper than it was in the 60s. People need to realize they're being robbed by their own government on top of being robbed by their own government.
So not only are we actually literally being robbed in the way that they come in, they take our taxes, under threat of violence, of losing your house, and you tell me if you try to prevent them from taking your house, they will kill you. They will put a bullet in your head. So it is the actual threat of violence. They tax you, or they steal your stuff. And then on top of that, they make the money that you have worth less than it's supposed to be worth by basically creating more of it.
Right. Do you think that a farmer today produces less than a farmer from the 60s?
Produce a lot of more.
He produces a lot more, especially with the advent of fertilizers and stuff like that. It's become cheaper and cheaper for them to produce the same amount. So why does bread keep going up?
Because the value of the dollar keeps going down.
Well, there you go.
Da, da, da. You know, actually, this is nothing new. This has been going on for as long as there have been government-issued coins.
It still is.
Yeah, because didn't they used to actually physically shave off the edges of the coins? That's why we have those little marks on the edge of the coins to make sure that we can tell. Yeah, go ahead. Don't step up, Elaine. You're not in your head. Yes, yes. But that goes all the way back to Roman times.
Coin clipping.
Yeah, because people just like the platinum or the gold or the...
A little closer to the mic, yeah.
The platinum or the gold or the silver in the coin.
So they would actually shave off part of the coin itself, and so they would steal some of the coin.
Unjust weight and measure.
Yeah, like let's say like a dollar is not even a real dollar. A coin is a dollar. If let's say I grabbed a piece of paper and wrote one basketball, would that be one basketball?
Here's a great way to say it for people that can't get their mind around the fact that their money becomes worth less daily is if, let's pretend that titles to vehicles were money, okay? And we had 10 vehicles with 10 titles, and that's how money started out. That's how they first get people to swallow it, is that a dollar bill is worth a dollar worth of silver in the bank, but you get to carry around this convenient note. So if I had 10 vehicles and 10 titles, and we were all swapping titles for money, you know, because there's some monetary value behind it, and all of a sudden I go home and I print out 10 more titles, and now I have 20 titles, but there's still only 10 cars. Those titles would be worth exactly half of what they were. You're being robbed daily by this government, and they keep inflating more and more. I mean, it's not like they inflate the same amount. It's 10 times the amount, 100 times the amount, 500 times the amount.
Yeah, like people think that prices are rising, but it's really not.
No, prices are going down because we keep getting more and more efficient because we're awesome.
Now, Jim, down there in Kenai, things aren't that much different than they are up here in Fairbanks in terms of the price of goods, right? Sorry, Jim, you still there?
Yes.
All right. So the prices aren't that much different in Kenai than they are in Fairbanks.
No, I've only been up briefly, but no, I didn't notice them being substantially different.
Okay, and no, what about the wages in Kenai?
Don't know. I work on Texas wages, so I really don't know.
My mom just texted me and made a good point. They should just keep it to stealing from us through inflation and give us our 40% back, and then we could actually afford their inflation if we could afford gas.
You know what? I liked it better, the idea that they should keep it to stealing actual physical stuff.
Yes.
Instead of taxing us on the money that they print, they should come into my house and take what they want. That way I know that they are stealing, and they know that they are stealing.
But the inflation makes it impossible to plan long term, because because you have your guy who, you know, a man gets married and he buys a life insurance policy for his wife for an amount that he thinks will provide for her, and the value of that life insurance policy is constantly going down, but he doesn't know exactly how fast it's going down, so it's impossible to plan for retirement in a meaningful way. It's impossible to provide for your family in a meaningful way over the long term, because you never know just how much money the government's going to print.
Here's a little story. When I was growing up in Brazil, the inflation was out of control. Government print so much money that price was going up three times a day, and going up not a little bit, but it was a lot, like 10% a day sometimes, depends the product. So to control that, you got a great president, right, that got our... So what he did, he went to the bank, closed all the banks one Friday, and opened on next Thursday or something like that. And anybody have over a certain amount of money, their money was confiscated, because this was the only way to control the inflation they had, because it was too much money on the market. So what you have too much becomes cheap. And they keep putting more money become cheaper and cheaper. And get a point that people don't, it's not only to have too much money, but people don't believe on the money anymore. So prices start to rise, not only because you have more money in the market, but because people want to have us charge more. So to cover for the next day, they'll be costing more.
Well, like our run on the banks in the 20s that produced our depression. And people just lost faith in the money.
Well, in the expectation that the money printing is going to continue. That's the only thing that the revaluing ever does, is it breaks people's expectation of continued printing, but it's almost, you know, the continued printing is pretty much guaranteed to start up again anyway.
Well, sure, there's no easier way to steal than that.
That's a painless for the government. That's a painless tax. They can tax you by printing money, and you don't know they are taxing you. So there's no repercussion. If you get into the borough, for example, and they raise your tax, they double price of tax, people are going to be outraged and start going, you know, going to throw them out. That's the same in the government. They can tax you without you being mad at
it. Yeah, and when they raise the amount of money and inflation goes up, people tend to blame capitalism instead of the source of why their money is becoming worthless. Oh, Walmart's so terrible. We got to stop all this importating of Chinese goods.
Yeah.
Well, why do people think that? Why do people think that somehow it's Walmart's fault for importing cheap goods?
Because people have gotten so used to redistribution. It's why people sanctioned this system in the first place. Because when it comes to taxes, there's always tax recipients. People that want a fair tax are totally delusional and don't understand taxes in the first place. There's always tax givers and tax receivers. Always. There's always a redistribution of wealth. You can never have a fair tax.
It's always a gift to the people who receive it.
Yeah, fair tax is oxymoron, because how can it be fair if we work to get your food, and then somebody take 30% of that? How fair is that? They don't work for. And it's the same like you know, that business liberty tax. You know, there's nothing liberty about tax.
Liberty tax, yeah, that's great. So as long as we're on this monetary issue, and why is it that people continue to use the green stuff? Why is it that people continue to use these Federal Reserve dollars? We know intellectually that they're worth less every single day.
Because people are starting to get crazy, and now they just want whatever the government thinks is money. Whatever the government thinks is money, they take. They use.
The government won't enforce contracts on any written in anything else. I mean, it's legal tender. If you do not accept the government's money, then the government considers the attempt at discharging the debt to be complete. So if you offer greenbacks and somebody doesn't take it, then you're considered to have paid your debt even though they didn't accept it. That's legal tender.
And if you do try to make your own tender, they'll come and shut you down by force, right?
That's the Liberty Dollar guy.
What happened to the Liberty Dollar guy? Tell me about that.
He got charged as being an economic terrorist.
No, this was just a couple years ago, right, in Colorado, if I'm remembering correctly?
Yeah, I haven't tracked him lately, but yeah, Nussbaum or something, Newhouse, something like that. He was trying to have silver commodity money, pretty high premium, but still worthwhile. He got all of it confiscated and charged as being an economic terrorist, and I don't remember exactly what happened to him. I saw his name pop up recently. Kind of lost track of that, though. Can I talk for a second about, Steve brought up the idea of you know, giving us a little anarchist enclave with restrictions, and I'll say this, I'd move there. I don't know, you know, I'd move there. That would be great, but it's not the end point, and the exceptions that he made would be the downfall if they weren't eradicated fairly quickly. You know, you can't have if the state is exercising jurisdiction, that's going to be its shoehorn for getting more jurisdiction. But I that would be a start.
I live and work for a while in Bolivia, in a very remote area where government didn't have a reach on it. And people there, you know, live on their own. They're all poor, because only poor people would go to live that far. The people with more money would live in the city, on that place. But everybody get along. Nobody would kill each other every day, and nobody would steal what. They were very helpful. Like one day, they have an airplane come with a missionary that was going to do, you know, do treatment, do medicines and check their health and stuff. And they have a little landfill there where the airplane would land. And now everybody got together and with machetes and cleared the field so the airplane could land safely, you know, for their own good. was all voluntary. Nobody make anybody do that. They were, was like almost like a party, you know, a big event to go and make better their own community. So anarchy, death, work.
So the reason they're able to maintain without a state is because it costs more to oppress them than they have to take.
That's a good point.
That's correct. That's the reason.
And what if we made it harder and more expensive for the borough to oppress us? How could we do that?
Non-cooperation.
Non-cooperation. Meaning, for instance, if instead of paying your taxes when they say pay your taxes, you waited and got on that little tax delinquent list and only paid them the minimum amount after they've spent money trying to come get it, right? That'd be one way to come up the works.
Yeah, during the Depression, there was a huge tax revolt. People figured it was more important to pay to feed their family than to pay their property taxes. And that caused a lot of consternation on the part of the rulers.
Go ahead, Claudia.
Yeah, the thing is with tax, people need to get on their own heart, their own mind, that they can't say no to government. You are conditioned to say you cannot say no to government because you'll be a criminal. But if law is unjust, you should say no, because you work your life and you give half what you make to government to help people that you're forced to give money to people that didn't work for and then don't work for. That's not just, and that's a theft.
Yeah, but people feel like they're collectively participating in it, and that's how they justify it in their mind. That's why the form of state we have today versus a monarchy is such a hard nut to crack, is because everybody feels like they're part of it. They did it together.
Yeah, the government is their representative. They vote on it, so that's what they use for.
And yet if you don't vote, they say, oh, you don't have a right to complain. You didn't participate with us.
All right, it's the other way around. If you participated, you don't have a right to complain. That was our argument to Walter Block, mm-hmm. was if you're going to go and play in Vegas and you lose all your money, well, then you have no ground to stand up and say, well, I got ripped off. Because you gambled and lost. So if you participate in the vote, you really shouldn't be complaining about Obama at all. You get what you vote for, regardless of what you get.
You get what you get because you voted.
Right. So you're just because you didn't get the force to go your way, doesn't mean you should be able to complain. I don't think, anyway.
Well, was it like the day after the election? Everybody was saying, well, we just mean to work harder for next time. Really? Really?
Well, it looks like somebody's crazy enough to call us today.
We can go to the phones. 458-TALK, the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Good morning. Frank Turney here.
Frank Turney.
Uh-oh. Hey, I'm still riding on the fence when it comes to my right to vote. Most of all, mine's more of a personal thing. You know, I was found guilty here by an ignorant jury for telling the truth about their rights to vote their conscience and judge the law as well as the facts.
All right, but that's a different kind of voting,
yeah.
Frank.
Right, but I'm getting back to my right to vote for somebody to run for office. You know, wasn't too many years ago I voted for you.
Right, I understand.
I found an argument. It says Aaron Bennett is filed for federal assembly. See, what happened if you'd have been elected, Aaron? I'm just curious. What would you have done?
Well, they probably would have ran me out of town.
No, but I'm serious. At that time, you must have
The same reason, what I would have done is the reason I didn't get voted in. I very plainly said that I would stop any redistribution of wealth of any kind.
Which is exactly what happened, is that you were too honest.
And people didn't vote for me based on that reason.
Well, you know, I'm running for office because of a conscious awareness on subject matters that hopefully that'll rub off on the other person that is elected, and hopefully it'll have a positive effect on the people at large.
Right, but it never does. I mean, it's always forced one way or the other.
Well, I learned the hard way. I didn't run. Usually there's a rule that I run on anybody that run unopposed. I run against Gay Ramis because he never run. Nobody ran against him. I run against Jerry Cleaver because nobody ran against him. And this time, I
know, and I always get a kick out of your running, and I think it's great. But the reality of it is, Frank, is you don't have a right to vote because you don't have a right to assert your will over me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess, you know, I don't think that these people are less people that do vote, though.
No, I mean, I agree with...
I'm talking about libertarian right to vote. I think the libertarians have no problem for people to get out there and vote in their conscience at the ballot box or anything.
Right. A minarchist doesn't have a problem with that, but I've pointed out that this argument that the minarchist makes is the same argument that the one-world government proponent makes.
Basically, the argument is invalid because it comes down to the point of saying, at what point, Frank, do you have the right to tell me what to do? If you and all of your buddies got together and voted to tell me that I have too many children and I have to give one of them up, what right do you have to tell me to do that?
Or if they don't have the right genetic makeup.
Yeah.
We already decided that right here in Fairbanks, that if your kid doesn't have the right genetic makeup, that it's legal to murder him.
Yeah, I feel uncomfortable being King Frank.
But Frank, isn't it true that right here in Fairbanks, Alaska, if your kid doesn't have the right genetic makeup, you can terminate that life?
Right.
Absolutely.
Well, there's no doubt that...
But that's something that's been voted on.
There's no doubt that we need change in this country. You know, I don't like both parties.
But not through the vote, Frank. Not through the vote.
I personally wouldn't have a problem with vote and people have their representatives if I was not forced to participate on it.
Sure, exactly. If it was voluntary.
Which goes back to the issue of the unions. I mean,
no one would even waste their time voting at all if it was voluntary, because the whole point of voting is force.
Now, you're just referring to the ballot box to get somebody elected. You're not talking about other votes like Thomas Jefferson. He was voted by one vote to get in the House of Representatives to be the president.
And right. And what did he do once he became president?
Right. I don't know. Today, it's a shot in the dark.
You know, it was a shot in the dark with Jefferson. He was just as corrupt as any of them once he became president.
Well, Abe Lincoln.
Everything that he said that America shouldn't do, he did when he became president.
Yeah, Abe Lincoln, he did more than the Patriot Act.
It's the humanitarian with the guillotine problem. It doesn't matter how well-intentioned you are. Once you're part of the state, you only have one tool. And it's
off with their heads!
The guillotine.
Well, I'll tell you what, I really appreciate Aaron and your brother Josh and this radio station, Patriot's Land, because this might be the new beginning for an educational revolution.
Well, thanks, you. Frank. We appreciate you too, Frank.
Thank you.
Appreciate you participating all the time, too.
But
it's good.
I think, Jim, you gave me new ammo. You just enlightened me in a new way to argue. You only have one tool available to you. You're absolutely right. That says it in a nutshell. Brilliant. There's only one tool, and it's force. Or you, like you said, the guillotine. But for a better way to say it, in my opinion, the only tool you have with the state is force.
Yeah, and the folks who are calling for a revolution now, the only thing they're going to get is a French Revolution. Blood in the streets.
And that's what they're calling for, though.
And that's what's happening in Egypt right now. Look what's happening. Right now, today, in Egypt, blood is flowing in the streets, and it's not just... It's not just the government people that are getting killed. It's not just the police that are getting pushed off the bridges. It's Christians. There's a whole-scale slaughter going on today, right now.
Here, the news for that, they're using American weapons that we gave them. They robbed the American taxpayer and give foreign aid. But if the foreign aid, a big percent of that has to be to buy back weapons from the military-industrial complex in the United States. So we are indirectly participating in the killing of civilians there.
Well, and there's nothing new with that. American taxpayers having their money being used to go and kill innocent people.
Since the time of Thomas Jefferson.
Back to Thomas Jefferson. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We've got one last half-hour segment to go right here on Patriots Lament. If you'd like to get in queue, we've got two lines on hold. Queue lines are open at 458-TALK. Jim and Kenai is on hold with us on KFAR.
Keep it here for Fox News, next on KFAR.
Fox News Radio. I'm Lillian Wu. The Egyptian government considers outlawing the Muslim Brotherhood as supporters of the deposed president continue clashing with security forces.
The streets of Cairo look like an urban battlefield as the Muslim Brotherhood's protest turned into armed insurrection. Security forces had to storm a local mosque in order to get gunmen out of the minarets who were firing down at the crowd.
Fox's Leland Vittert. In Idaho, as a wildfire rages near Sun Valley, some residents being told,
if you have been issued a mandatory evacuation order, please leave your home.
Drought conditions and high winds threatening some 1,600 homes, including multi-million dollar ones. And the Florida Keys may be pulling out the high-flying high-tech in the fight against mosquitoes, considering being the first in the nation to use drones to spot remote breeding grounds. Fox News, we report, you decide.
So you want to share something you heard on one of our shows with someone who missed the program? Become a member of the 660 Club, and you can listen online to our archives, KFAR660.com.
Welcome back to Patriots Lament right here on KFAR, Local Talk Radio. Joining us in the studio, we've got Aaron Bennett. Good morning, Aaron.
Good morning.
We've also got Corolla Diogomez
Habanero
over there. Good morning, Claudio.
Good morning.
And we've got Spawn of Aaron, Elijah. Good morning, Elijah. Good morning.
Still got Jim on?
Jim, you still there?
Yes, I'm still here.
All right, awesome. We also have three lines on hold. But before we go to the phones, Aaron, you wanted to clarify that remark about Thomas Jefferson.
Yeah, just in case anyone was wondering why we threw it back to Thomas Jefferson is because he used tax money to attack the Barbary Pirates. And that was because of businessmen's interest, basically lobbying him to get involved in that so they could make more money. And he did it.
They should have to pay the cost of their own shipping insurance.
That's exactly right. That was a classic example of overseas intervention so the rich could get richer.
And that is a classic example. It's one of those things that has gotten me all teary-eyed over the years because, I mean, that's where we got the Leathernecks from, was that little excursion against the Barbary Pirates. The very first time that we sent troops overseas, right? Not the last. It was the very first time the United States troops were sent overseas specifically to go and attack another nation or another nation's members because they were attacking United States citizens. Well, look, who was it that sent those United States citizens overseas? Did anybody make them go and do business over there?
No.
Weren't they taking their own life into their own hands, their own risk by going over there?
Sure. It was interventionism at its finest. And Thomas Jefferson was fully aware of what was going on, and he used the power that he had at his disposal for other people's gain. And he stole from the American people to make it happen, and stole human life to make it happen. He's just as sick as anybody else. And I love the guy to death, but Once he held the reins of power, he was as bad as any of them. And he admitted it himself. So did George Washington admit it himself, that he, once he had the reins of power, he did things that were wrong.
Yeah, that's it. That's what I keep saying. You probably heard many times saying that government came to rob, to kill, and destroy, and that's the fruits of government. You can't get away from it. No matter how good you are, your heart is, how good intentions are, when you get to power, you are participating with evil, and you become evil.
Right. I have a hard time personally believing that Ron Paul would have been immune to it, because there's been men, in my opinion, that were greater than him, Thomas Jefferson being one of them, that wasn't immune to it.
I would argue that Obama was have a good intention, and he wants to do the right thing. You see, you hear his speeches, everything before he became president was one thing. Then he became president, everything changed. He acts like George Bush and worse.
Right, if you... Here's a good little homework for anybody that likes to educate themselves that listen to the show. Go look at how many Democrats got us into wars, and go look at how many Republicans raised taxes. It's almost verbatim, each and every one. Democrats got us into all the wars, except for Bush, and Republicans raised all the taxes. It's mind-blowing.
All right, you ready to go back to the phones?
Yep.
Jim?
Sure.
458 Talk, the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
It's Winston.
Winston, what's on your mind today, brother?
Mulling a lot of different things over. Randy called in about the enclave of anarchists, thing. Technically, to a weak extent, we already have that in Alaska. It's called the unorganized borough. People that live outside the boroughs and live outside of city limits and stuff like that, they can pretty much do whatever they want to. Still have to answer to the state for some things if they want to pay any attention to them, but not necessarily, you know. They still, a lot of the people that came to Alaska to get away from everything, that can, if they just want to. You can't live in downtown Fairbanks and do it. Unless you change Fairbanks.
It's kind of a singular thing there though, Winston. The only thing would be the borough's property tax. That's the only thing you're relieving yourself of.
You're also relieving yourself of the borough's regulations. Understood. Like I said, it's not a total flip side, but it. There is some relief. You're less regulated and you're less taxed.
All right, that's the way Michael Dukes always writes it off to everybody, though, is if you don't like it, leave. I think that's a sorry excuse to suffer oppression.
Don't misunderstand me. I would love to see every borough in the state disappear. I would love to see the administrative state of Alaska disappear. Josh, a month or so ago, was talking about he had read something and said you can have government without an administrative state. There's hardly anybody in this world that will accept absolutely no government. But if we can get rid of the administration, and I'm not talking about limited government or whatnot, the limited administrative state. I'm just talking about getting rid of the administrative state. That would be an ideal situation.
Well, Winston, I mean, even in the unorganized borough, all you need is for enough of your neighbors to get together and have a little vote, and they can incorporate you into their newly formed borough.
They got a fight on their hands.
It's what's going on down in Nenana right now.
Understood.
You know, there are people down there that are pushing hard to get those folks who don't want to be in a borough and to go out there and scoop them up and make them a part of the borough so they can tax them.
Right. I don't think that saying you can move a little bit down the road and get a little bit more freedom. I'm going to stay right here, and I don't care about getting rid of all the boroughs in Alaska. I don't care about ending the state's control in Alaska. I care, well, maybe Jim cares a little bit, but I care about right here. You know, my posterity's right here. I'm right here. My brothers are here. My family's here. I want Fairbanks to be free.
Well, and like I say, that's what I'm getting at is all politics, just like all, you know, it's local. You change your locality, Jim changes his locality, Frank Turney changes his locality. What I'm getting at is change the structure of the locality.
Right, and I may get sick of it at some point and move to Chile. I've been thinking about it quite a bit. But while there's still some fight in me and before I've totally given up on humans and totally told myself that they're never going to give up robbing and they're never going to give up stealing from each other killing each other to get that plunder, I'm going to stay here and fight.
I got some friends that moved out of state because and they moved somewhere else, and they got there, and now they're having just about as much trouble there as they had here, you know. And you can't run away from your problems. You've got to change the problem.
Well, you have to start with changing your own head, Winston, and that's part of what this show is all about. I mean, look what happened to the pilgrims,
and the
Puritans that came here, right?
I greatly love the show because what you're doing is you're making people think. You're giving people opportunities to study, showing them different sources and stuff. But like I say, you've got to work at it locally. But all these greedy people will always seek to take from you.
Sure, but it's never been viable like it is now with the state. It was never viable for everybody to freely participate in coveting each other's property until the state came along. The state as we know it today, a territorial monopoly.
The administrative state, yeah.
Right, with universal suffrage. So that's why we attack it at its core, is to talk about how the state is the cause of every single person's problems. It's not this boogeyman that is going to jump out and bite you by the neck if the state's not there to protect you. It's the state itself that is biting you on the neck.
Right. It's the vampire that's sucking the blood right out of you. All right.
Good call. Thanks, Winston.
Right.
Appreciate you, brother. 458-TALK is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Robert.
Robert, what's on your mind?
Well, earlier you were talking about gold coinage being clipped in England during Newton's time, and Newton was put in charge of England's money supply because their money was being clipped until each one was very subsized. And with new technology, Newton was able to replace all the money, gold coins in England over about a year's time. And in the United States, we went from money, and then we have currency now, and this technology moves on just like for Newton. There's a thing called Bitcoin. And with Bitcoin, it's exchanged digitally, and lots of people accept it. It's accepted worldwide, and they have an interesting method of controlling inflation. There's going to be a set amount of it, and you carry your Bitcoins with you in your laptop, in your iPad, on your phone.
The only argument I have against Bitcoin, and I've actually argued with it for quite a few people. I like Bitcoin for one reason. The main reason I like Bitcoin is because the state hates it. And for me, that's good enough, and I'm a proponent of Bitcoin. I do like it, but my reasons are really shallow. I just stated them. The argument I have against Bitcoin I hate to argue against it at all, is that it was never a commodity money, and it never can be, and it never will be.
It'll be interesting to see where technology takes currency and money in the decades to come.
Right. I know there's some arguments going on at the at the Mises Institute over Bitcoin and all of the, you know, the hardline old timers, the gold standard, so to speak, guys, are all arguing that it wasn't a commodity money. And I understand where they're coming from. Is, you know, gold got its value, silver got its value from being the most saleable, right, Jim?
Yes.
I mean, the way that money becomes a currency is basically Bitcoin kind of defies that, the way that money becomes a money in the first place. You know, is obviously a double coincidence at once. It has to happen in a purely exchange market where you have to want what I have and I have to want what you have. And so, you know, if chickens are the most desirable thing, obviously I will go take, and I produce baskets, I'm going to go trade for chickens, even if I don't want chickens, because I know that they're going to, that I can go get what I really want, which is a plow, if I go trade my baskets for chickens, because everybody trades chickens. You know, and it's that line of reasoning, how you end up with gold and silver as being a money. And Bitcoin doesn't fall into that category. And that's my argument, that it's not a commodity money. It can never be used the way that gold and silver can, and why I'm not a proponent for it, like in the way that a lot of these new web guys are.
Besides, there are already a number of governments that are cracking down.
Yeah,
and
which is the reason I like it.
the Bitcoin kind of emerged within a sub community in the Mangarian Misesian way. But it isn't, the fact that it isn't a commodity does lead to a problem, because it would take one major advance in cryptography to completely collapse it. It would be in the same position gold and silver would be in if suddenly we were struck by a giant hunk of, you know, an asteroid made entirely of gold. So it's not like gold is perfect, but the you know, that's a relatively unlikely occurrence. But the possibility of a cryptography advance happening is more possible. And I was, even since I'm kind of involved in security software, I was reading that they're anticipating that all current encryption software may be out of date in the next decade.
I personally like the Bitcoin just because is a currency that's competing.
Oh, that's a great aspect of it.
But it's still a fiat kind of thing, because there's no value, it's worth what you believe is worth. And gold is rare and is real, and you can carry around. It's not a faith-based money like Bitcoin or dollar. I think what's happened Bitcoin was some security problem that brought down the price, right?
Right. And gold also has a value outside of its spendability, if that's even a word.
It has a non-monetary use. Bitcoin does not have a non-monetary use to hold up its value. So, but if Bitcoin holds up, the use of Bitcoin is specifically as a counteraction to the government fiat currency. So it could work, and I hope it does.
Right, just the fact that it makes the state angry.
Yeah, I love that.
I tell people to use it. I love it.
All right, we've got about 11 minutes left. Want to go back to the phones? 458 talk the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
This is Lee.
Lee, what's on your mind?
Did I mishear our president here in this last week give a speech that said we're not choosing sides in Benghazi, and we're not giving support, and I'll paraphrase, of any kind, money or guns, to either side of that conflict?
Jim?
I don't know. I don't tend to listen to the man.
When you say Benghazi, did you mean Egypt?
Yeah.
Okay.
He
did say something along those lines, but which is why the government canceled the exercises that the United States government has had with the Egyptian government going on.
Yeah. Yes, in Egypt, that was his statement that we didn't, you know, the United States isn't choosing sides or whatever over there. And it just seems to me we have a track record of billions of dollars going to Egypt over the last decade or so, each year of that period of time or longer. And so, again, if his lips are moving, you know what he's doing.
We intervene in every country, yeah, whether exactly. Obama's our president or not. Obama didn't get us into this thousand-year war that's been going on forever in the Middle East.
But he says we're not supporting either side or anybody, I guess. Maybe
right, but Franklin Roosevelt said the same thing when the Nazis were on the rise. It became prudent for him to jump into World War II.
Right.
Which, you know, I have my own personal view on that, and I think is really substantiated by the movie The Rape of Europa, which they weren't even trying to make their issue out of the fact that Hitler was going and taking down all the world bankers. They were making their issue out of the paintings that he was stealing from them. But Hitler was very adamant that the world banks had started all the wars that had happened in the last, you know, 400 or 500 years, and he was making it his mission statement to take them down, and he was going to their personal mansions and taking everything they had, absolutely robbing them blind, and then ransoming the family members back to other world bankers. And
well, where do you think he got that?
He would come on national radio and say, I'm striking blows for liberty for mankind the world round. And
he was just following in the footsteps of what the Japanese had done to that part of the world for a decade or longer, preceding World War II.
Right, but my point is that Franklin Roosevelt, who got elected based on him saying that he would keep us out of World War II, all of a sudden did a 160, or a 360, sorry. And
all the way around, or just a 180? Just a 180.
That.
368. I haven't slept in like 20 hours.
He did
hours,
a 180.
So a
he went exactly the opposite. Not 360. All
right.
The way
he
back
did
around.
A 180. I was almost there with a 160.
All right.
He did a 180, and all of a sudden decided that it was very urgent that we get involved in that war. And why is that? Was he being pressured? Of course he was being pressured. I mean, so basically what I'm getting at is to say that for Obama to say that We're not involved in it in any way. We're involved in everything. We're the world's reserve currency. We operate on petroleum-based currency. Our money's propped up by the fact that we control the world's petroleum. Of course we're involved. We're involved in anything that has to do with anything.
Right. I will agree. But it's just another strike against the man when he says that, you know, we're not supporting either side, and if we ever get Benghazi figured out, we may be able to figure out.
We're never going to get anything figured out because we're not those people. We have no business being there.
Well, and as long as we keep focusing on the man who's in office, we're not going to get past the problem either. The fact is that we are meddling in other people's affairs.
Well, it's justified in the American's mind because we believe we're making the world safe for democracy. I mean, that's the Republicans have been crying that since World War One, that we were going to throw down these monarchies.
And we were the Democrats.
What's happened in Egypt? It's not a new thing. You are supporting the military there for over 40 years. We have Mubarak was just the face of that military government, and now you got somebody that was not from their side, so
democratically elected.
Yes, and now they didn't like because they want somebody else. The United States wants somebody else, so you didn't like. So that guy came down. The military took over. But you are still giving money to them, or you're going to still give a weapon to them. The only difference now they have is looking bad. They're just doing that out of shame, embarrassment, because it's very clear that they are dictators, they are criminals, and they're killing their own people right now. And our government don't want to have that image on them, but it's still going to do that under wraps.
Of course, we didn't care that Saddam Hussein was killing his own people until it became inconvenient for us to not care anymore. And we propped him up to
Because he was killing other brown people at the time.
Right. we propped him up to be a big block against the Iranian.
Well, he worked for us while he worked for us.
And right now,
get off the phone and let somebody else get in. But thanks for being there, guys.
Thanks, Lee. Appreciate your phone call.
Right now, we are supporting Al Qaeda in Libya.
I don't know. I don't pay attention to that crap.
Okay, you're supporting Al Qaeda in that revolution there in the Middle East, and they just have different look, different face.
Well, it's because it's for American interests, just like all the children that died in Iraq. It was an acceptable loss for American interests.
And if you follow Al-Qaeda history, who creates Al-Qaeda? Was CIA creates Al-Qaeda. Osama Bin Laden was on payroll from the CIA.
And in a sense, our military involvement in other countries creates Al-Qaeda. Regardless of where the actual structure came from, the fact that we keep on killing babies and wedding parties and 16-year-olds sitting in the back of their dad's car as collateral damage.
If we don't kill them over there, Steve, they'll come over here on their camels.
That's very true. I'm sure that they've got flying goats that are going to come in at any moment and start attacking us in other places. The point, however, is, I mean, if any other country were doing that here,
I'd ride my freaking goat over to Iraq if they were over here killing my family.
I'm just saying.
I would get that goat right across the ocean.
Pick your country, whether it's the Chinese or the North Koreans or even the Canadians. If they set up a military base in downtown Fairbanks and were patrolling our streets, armed to the teeth, just by their very presence, wouldn't that be enough to piss you off enough to go out there and plant a bomb?
We'd tear them apart.
Just for being here.
Yeah, but they don't, you don't understand. They weren't sanctioned by God to spread democracy.
I forgot about that part. 458-TALK is the number. Good morning, caller. Who's this?
Hello,
who's this?
This is George.
George, what's on your mind?
Well, on my mind, they keep talking about, like Michael Dukes and Michael Kraft, they're talking about natural gas on the slope getting down here to alleviate energy problems, and how if they don't get that here, people are going to start leaving town here and it's going to become a ghost town. They don't ever talk about nuclear power and how that breeder reactors could fuel this whole place forever, pretty much, just like France uses.
That's because truck and natural gas, people have interest in that.
You see, right.
More government monopolies make certain people rich.
But they've never talked about nuclear power and how that could, you know, alleviate energy problems up here.
Well, anytime that you start looking to somebody else to solve your energy problem,
we don't need nuclear power. We need coal power, but all the coal is privately owned up here, and so they keep it shut down. That's the long and short of it.
Yeah, and earlier you're talking about how people, once they get into power, they get corrupted. Well, then the simple answer to that is people, humans are fallen creatures, and they have demons following them, and as well as angels. So they're always going to have those two influences on them.
Which is why government is not possible.
Thank you so much for your show.
Thank you very much for calling in. I appreciate you. Jim, thanks for being with us today. Do you have a website or anything people can go and check out?
No, just Patriots Lament. If I could mention one thing, though, everything that makes life without a state suboptimal makes life with a state intolerable.
Absolutely.
Ooh, good point.
And you can find Jim on Facebook. He's always posting something worth reading, I think, anyway.
Well, he's always posting something.
Can I say your name, Jim and Keenan?
Sure, go ahead.
It's Jim O'Connor on Facebook, if you want to find him. And it's like the Irish O'Connor.
And our own website here, patriotslament.blogspot.com, is that right? Or is it .org? .com?
I don't know. That's Josh's job to say
patriotslament.blogspot.com, I think.
.com, that's right.
And the YouTube channel is Radio Free Fairbanks.
And you can find me on Facebook, Aaron Bennett, if you're interested in getting some books that kind of outline the things that we're talking about. And I have anybody that has asked me about it, I'll try and get back to you today.
And we will see you next week at 9 o'clock right here on Patriots Lament. Up next, it's Health Talk on KFAR Local Talk Radio. And I will be back in the studio on Monday morning at 6 a.m.
Don't touch that dial. Fairbanks is listening.